you've ever experienced a high water bill and don't know why, you're not alone. For the past year, I've been trying to figure out why my water bill has trended upward. Is there a leak I can't find? Am I watering too much? Am I using too much water indoors? Or is there another issue that I'm unable to detect? Toby, since we bought our house about a year and a half ago, we've had really unusual high water bills. As a homeowner, where do we start? How do we help kind of track that down?
So the first thing is on our website, snwa.com, we have a great tool that you can use to kind of figure out how much water you use. It's called the Water Use Estimator. So you go onto the website and you put in, actually your address goes into the information, and it just asks you some basic questions like how old are your appliances and toilets, or just if you kind of generally know how old the house is, how much landscaping is grass and desert landscaping. So you put all that kind of information in, and then it will give you information on how much water you should be using. So that'll give you the ballpark, you know, and if you're way above that, then maybe you need to kind of go to your house and kind of see what's going on and why you're using more water. And so a good example is taking a look at the meter. And so what you want to do is when you first come to the house, you want to have all your water off, indoor, outdoors, nothing running. And then you want to look at your meter. So most of them are labeled, it says water, and you take the lid off. And what you're going to do is you're going to look at the dial, and you want to see no movement on the dial at all. So there is actually a big dial, which is in the hundreds of gallons, but the little dial is in tens of gallons. So the little dial will actually capture any type of small leaks. So if you have a toilet leak or anything that's happening, it will show up on this. So that's what you want to do to start off with, is look at your meter and see if there's anything going on. And then after that, you can kind of start looking at other stuff to see where you may have a leak at.
So our initial home inspection did identify some broken sprinkler heads and even an underground irrigation leak. So we had those repaired. But as a homeowner, what are some things that we should be looking for regular maintenance in our landscape?
I think one of the things that people need to understand is so much water goes outside compared to inside. Yet people tend to not want to go around just doing a walk when stuff is running. And so what you want to do, there's a handful of things to look at, and it starts with your valves. So they're in the valve box. It's where there's bugs and all the critters and things that people don't want to mess with. But that's really where all the irrigation happens, and that's where most of the leaks happen. Then after that, you just want to kind of walk around your yard when things are running. And so when your spray system, if you have grass, is running, you want to make sure all your heads are aligned, that they're actually watering on the grass, not on your walls in the house. Or if there's broken heads, which means there's water shooting straight out. If you have drip systems, sometimes that's under the ground, so you don't see it so much, but you do want to look for wet spots, you know, where there are places that they shouldn't be.
So another thing that we discovered was that we are watering for too long. So we adjusted our clock to water for a few minutes at a time rather than 15 minutes. How does your watering time affect your water bill?
So scheduling through irrigation controller is like one of the most important things with your irrigation system. So, I mean, by just changing from, say, watering one of your zones from 4 minutes to like 8 minutes, you could all of a sudden be doubling, obviously, in the amount of time, but how much water is going out. So it's really important to know how to schedule through your controller. It's also key because, you know, we have our watering restrictions where you can only water certain days a week. And so obviously you have to control that through the controller itself. So you really need to know how to operate the controller. So one of the things I always tell people, if the controller is too complicated and they don't know, you know, intuitively how to work it, go to your hardware store, spend $50, $75, buy a new controller that makes sense, because then there's a better likelihood that you're going to get in there and change the controller.
For us, we actually realized that we were changing our clock and we thought we were changing the time back, but it wasn't communicating with our irrigation system, and we had a faulty irrigation clock. How often do you have to check up on your clock, or do they have a life cycle?
It kind of varies. I mean, it depends. Obviously, if you have an outdoor controller versus an indoor controllers will last longer than the outside ones because of weather and things. But it's just one of the things you need to check on. There is a battery in there as a backup, so you can make sure that's up to date, you know, you have a good battery. But it's just, you just kind of monitor it. I mean, if it's not running when you're telling it to running, or if things are not going off when they should be going off, or going on when they're not should be, then you probably, it's time to get a new controller.
During some routine maintenance, our landscaper actually noticed our anti-siphon valve was leaking, so he repaired that. But what is the anti-siphon valve, and why is it important to keep that in good working condition?
So the anti-siphon valve, or sometimes they call it a backflow preventer, it serves a purpose on a property so that when there is a fire event or something where there's a giant vacuum occurring, basically a water, it doesn't pull irrigation water back into the drinking potable water. So it actually is a critical component of any type of property around the valley. On residential properties, it can be a big source of leaks though, because what happens is there's constant water in there. And so when we freeze, when we do freeze, it actually will crack the top of that, and then there's a source of leaks. So whenever we have a freezing event, there'll be lots of calls about, I have this weird device on the side of my house that all of a sudden is squirting water out of the top. And that's probably what you had in your house as well. And so it is something else when you're kind of checking around the property to check it, because there's constant water going into that device. The other thing you want to make sure that you do is in the winter time, because it can crack, is to cover it. They sell them at the hardware stores, just like a sleeve that goes over it, or you can sometimes just wrap a towel or something that just kind of keeps the temperature of it slightly.
Now that we've covered pretty much everything we can outdoors, what are some of the things I should be looking for inside the house?
In general, there's not as much water going inside and outside. But inside, the key thing you want to check is actually the toilets. So toilet flappers is the biggest source for leaks inside the house. And so an easy way to do that is to put like a dye tablet or food coloring in the tank. You wait a few minutes and see if there's water, the coloring actually coming into the bowl. That tells you there's a leak. Besides that, you can just check like aerators, faucets, you know, just kind of the general things that use water have the potential to have leaks. But there's usually not that much inside compared to all the things that can happen outside.
One thing that was a red flag for my husband and I, we got a letter from our water provider saying they detected continuous water flow on our property. And since we had fixed all the things outdoors, we were kind of caught off guard. We called a leak detection company to come in and do their work, and they found that we had a subsurface leak under the foundation of the house. So we had to get that repaired. Is that something that can be helpful to homeowners also?
Sure. So all the purveyors around the valley will send a letter to customers if there's a continuous leak occurring. However, that doesn't capture all the outdoor leak stuff that we talked about, like with irrigation, because that occurs after the valve. And so it has to do with constant leaks, which is like your main line or under the house. And so in that case, they'll send you, the purveyor will actually get the data, and then they'll send the information to the customer about, you know, you have an ongoing leak.
That was really helpful for me. We hope that you learned something too. But if you still have any more questions, we have lots of videos online. Visit snwa.com.